William Morrow and Harper Audio present Will Trent Books 5 through 7, a Karin Slaughter thriller collection featuring Fallen, Criminal, and Unseen, written by Karin Slaughter and performed by Kathleen Early.
HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Fallen, a novel by Karin Slaughter. Performed by Kathleen Early. Introduction. I was delighted to be asked to write introductions for the first four Will Trent novels. While many of my characters are created organically, in response to a story or theme I'm trying to explore, I wrote Will with very deliberate intentions, from his first introduction early on in Triptych, to his partnering with Faith Mitchell in Fractured, to being pulled into Sarah Linton's orbit in Genesis and deeper still in Broken. Every step Will took, every thought he had was part of a plan that was first created inside the Grant County world. Unlike Sarah or Jeffrey or even my standalone characters, Will was not created for a story. Will was the story. It's difficult to talk about the origins of Will Trent without revealing some massive spoilers about the Grant County series, if not actual plot points, then character arcs. So, reader, consider this a warning that I'm going to have an open and honest conversation about why I decided to stop writing about Grant County and why I created Will Trent. That is, as open and honest as you can expect from someone who has, for the last 17 years, made a living by telling stories. When I created Sarah, Jeffrey, and Lena in Grant County, I was fulfilling the old writer's edict that you should write what you know. I grew up in a small town, and from an early age, I understood intrinsically how small towns operated. In fact, small towns are universal whether they're in South Georgia or the south of France or South Friesland. There's always the same cast of characters. The rich families, the poor folk, the trashy people, the loose women, the hypocrites, and the criminals. To have something shockingly bad happen, like a murder or a serial rapist or a pedophile stalking children in a seemingly normal, everyday setting, was part of my overall goal to hold a mirror up to not just small-town society, but society as a whole. Crimes feel more real, more personal, and more violent when they happen in small towns. While I enjoyed writing about something I knew, small towns, I think a writer's purpose should also be to write about what they want to know. And I want to know why and how violence changes victims, families, investigators, and communities. I suppose this curiosity came from growing up in Georgia during a particularly violent time in American life, no more so than in Atlanta, where a serial killer was abducting and murdering children from 1979 until 1981. While I lived about 40 minutes away from where these crimes were happening, I was very aware that my daily existence had changed in very real ways in response to these brutal serial murders. I no longer could ride my bike on certain streets. I was forced to check in with my parents throughout the day, and even at night on television, there was no respite. Commercials were constantly announcing the time on the half hour and asking viewers, "Do you know where your children are?" Some of my earliest recollections of telling stories come from this time period. I remember quite clearly waking up in the middle of the night, sneaking into my older sister's room, holding a flashlight under my chin and whispering, "Who's killing the children?" She would start screaming. I would get scared by her screaming and start screaming myself, and then I would start crying, and then my parents would come in and punish my sister for making me so upset. Anyone who has a sibling will understand this dynamic. It's never the baby's fault. Thus, you could say from a very early age, I was encouraged to tell stories that scare people. It was this love of fear-mongering that brought me to writing crime fiction, and more specifically, writing Sarah Linton. If there was any one thing that took me down the road to Grant County, it was Sarah. She's basically everything I am not. Tall, red-headed, a medical doctor, and a bossy older sister. What we have in common is the desire to understand why people do the horrible things they do. Sarah is in a unique position to study possible answers to this question. As a pediatrician, she sees the potential of life walk through her door every single day. As a medical examiner, she witnesses firsthand the destruction wrought by violent death. I've spent the last 17 years writing about Sarah and other strong women, and one dynamic has not changed. It's incredibly difficult to write about an accomplished, smart woman without people hating her. As a society, we're wired to celebrate those characteristics in men, but we're incredibly suspect and critical of women who share the same qualities. To make Sarah feel less like a superhero and more like a woman you'd meet in the grocery store, I allowed her to make mistakes. Sometimes big mistakes that led to the bad guys, temporarily, getting away. I gave her a domineering mother and a baby sister who's always there to call her on her shit. Sarah's father loves her, but he also recognizes her faults. Lena Adams can't stand her, but that's mostly because Sarah thinks that Lena is too emotionally driven and dangerous to be trusted with Jeffrey Tolliver's life. To this day, not many give Sarah credit for being right. I remember quite clearly where I was when I decided that Jeffrey would die. I had just finished writing A Faint Cold Fear, the third Grant County novel, and it was one of those situations where my lizard brain figured out something important before my conscious brain did. I felt really hot and shaky, like I was getting the flu, and after a few hours of this, it came to me as a fully formed idea. Jeffrey had to die. I've always been the type of writer who thinks a few books ahead of the one I'm working on. Even if I don't have a firm plot, I know where the characters are going. At that point, in writing the Grant County series, I could clearly see the trajectory of Jeffrey and Sarah's relationship, and it was heading toward a happy ending. Reader, you think you want stories about people being happy, but you really don't. Happy people are boring. Either they have to keep fighting and breaking up, or they have to cheat on each other, or something awful has to happen to keep them interesting. After all they had been through, I couldn't see Jeffrey and Sarah choosing any of these false paths. Perhaps, more importantly, I did not want to end up being the Jessica Fletcher of Grant County. I mean, come on, why would anyone live in this incredibly violent, dangerous town? If I were to set stories in a large city, say, Atlanta, or write about a state cop rather than a small-town chief of police, wouldn't that open up my opportunities to kill people in new and exciting places? There were three more novels to come in the Grant County series, so I had a chance to plot out exactly how Jeffrey would die. By the time I wrote Faithless, I had started planting clues in the plots that would indicate to the careful reader the danger lurking ahead. Before writing the last novel in the series, I wrote a book I called A Standalone about a new character named Will Trent. I say that I called it a standalone because only my editor, my agent, and I knew that it was not. A lot of times authors are asked how long it takes to write a book. To me, it's not the writing that takes the most time, it's thinking about the characters. Will Trent was a character I thought about for 3 years. I liken his formation to a grain of sand turning into a pearl inside the oyster shell of my mind. I didn't want to just write another Jeffrey and set him in Atlanta. I wanted to think about Will as a fully formed man. What are his values? What kind of cop is he? What kind of man is he? Who are his friends? What is his situation like at work? Unlike Jeffrey, who was raised by an alcoholic mother and a convict father, Will grew up in state care, where he suffered a tremendous amount of abuse. I feel like this early exposure to violence made Will very wary of physical altercations, and in fact afraid of what violence can unleash inside of him. While Jeffrey was not afraid to slap around a suspect, Will is more likely to talk to them. Jeffrey, a former college athlete, is extremely self-confident in his body. Will, on the other hand, feels a sense of shame because of the scars on his body, as well as his dyslexia. If anything, Will understands criminals better than Jeffrey because he knows what it's like to try to hide something from the rest of the world. To me, the biggest difference between the two men is how they each responded the first time they met Sarah Linton. Jeffrey saw another beautiful woman to conquer. Will saw a smart, attractive doctor who was completely out of his league. Every character has a deep, dark secret. In fact, both Will and Sarah have some events in their pasts that readers don't yet know about. and might not ever know. Will is a man who is constantly struggling against his past. He's well aware of the statistics. Young men who grew up in state care have a more than 60% chance of ending up in prison later in life. I think Will's brush with the wrong side of the law was a wake-up call for him. The fact that Amanda Wagner, whose involvement in Will's life is a slowly unwrapped mystery, has been the great Oz behind the curtain is only part of the story. Will is stubborn and has a long history of agreeing with the women in his life, then doing whatever the hell he wants. But I think his moral compass, his desire to be a good person, is the reason why readers continue to root for him. If there is one defining trait that Will shares with Jeffrey, it is that each man experienced a moment in his life where he had to make a decision between letting his past dictate his future or dictating his future for himself. Jeffrey chose to stop being a cheating carouser and become the sort of man who deserves to be with Sarah. Will chose to be a good man because the only other option was being the kind of man Angie Pulaski admired. As with Jeffrey, Will's act of self-determination is fundamental to who he is as a man, as a cop, as a partner and friend, and as the person with whom Sarah Linton eventually falls in love. Saturday. Chapter 1. Faith Mitchell dumped the contents of her purse onto the passenger seat of her Mini, trying to find something to eat. Except for a furry piece of gum and a peanut of dubious origin, there was nothing remotely edible. She thought about the box of nutrition bars in her kitchen pantry, and her stomach made a noise that sounded like a rusty hinge groaning open. The computer seminar she'd attended this morning was supposed to last 3 hours, but that had stretched into 4.5 thanks to the jackass in the front row who kept asking pointless questions. The Georgia Bureau of Investigation trained its agents more often than any other agency in the region. Statistics and data on criminal activities were constantly being drummed into their heads. They had to be up to date on all of the latest technology. They had to qualify at the range twice a year. They ran mock raids and active shooter simulations that were so intense that for weeks after, Faith couldn't go to the bathroom in the middle of the night without checking shadows and doorways. Usually, she appreciated the agency's thoroughness. Today, all she could think about was her 4-month-old baby and the promise Faith had made to her mother that she would be back no later than noon. The clock on the dash read 10 after 1 o'clock when she started the car. Faith mumbled a curse as she pulled out of the parking lot in front of the Panthersville Road headquarters. She used Bluetooth to dial her mother's number. The car speakers gave back a staticky silence. Faith hung up and dialed again. This time, she got a busy signal. Faith tapped her finger on the steering wheel as she listened to the bleating. Her mother had voicemail. Everybody had voicemail. Faith couldn't remember the last time she'd heard a busy signal on the telephone. She had almost forgotten the sound. There was probably a crossed wire somewhere at the phone company. She hung up and tried the number a third time. Still busy. Faith steered with one hand as she checked her BlackBerry for an email from her mother. Before Evelyn Mitchell retired, she had been a cop for just shy of 4 decades. You could say a lot about the Atlanta force, but you couldn't claim they were behind the times. Evelyn had carried a cell phone back when they were more like purses you strapped around your shoulder. She'd learned how to use email before her daughter had. She'd carried a BlackBerry for almost 12 years. But she hadn't sent a message today. Faith checked her cell phone voicemail. She had a saved message from her dentist's office about making an appointment to get her teeth cleaned, but there was nothing new. She tried her phone at home, thinking maybe her mother had gone there to pick up something for the baby. Faith's house was just down the road from Evelyn's. Maybe Emma had run out of diapers. Maybe she'd needed another bottle. Faith listened to the phone ring at her house, then heard her own voice answer, telling callers to leave a message. She ended the call. Without thinking, she glanced into the back seat. Emma's empty car seat was there. She could see the pink liner sticking out over the top of the plastic. Idiot, Faith whispered to herself. She dialed her mother's cell phone number. She held her breath as she counted through 3 rings. Evelyn's voicemail picked up. Faith had to clear her throat before she could speak.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.